I want to start by saying that I would like to plainly state that the challenges that queer young people of color face are a result of the hindrances that are beyond their control, oftentimes created by the systems and institutions in which they function. So that is my opening statement. So I want to zoom out a bit and provide some more context. And looking at our current context, we have what we know the devastating impact of COVID-19 on marginalized communities. We have anti-trans bills that seem to be popping up weekly. We have racialized and state-sanctioned violence. We even have the recent discovery of additional mass graves of Native American children. And the list continues. Now, couple these with the ongoing realities of housing insecurity, healthcare inaccessibility, and limited financial resources, which exist because of racism, cissexism, classism, and queerphobia. With all of this, we can only just begin to understand the reality of many young queer folk of color in this country who are simply trying to survive long enough to move from emerging adulthood to early adulthood and beyond. And we know that the terms for experiencing these various isms is called multiple minority stress, and our younger queer folks of color are in the thick of it. Again, they're responding to various forms of discrimination and stigma, all while trying to establish themselves as adults. So we know from research that mental health implications of multiple minority stress is limited, but we could make a few educated guesses based on what we do know about health disparity data for LGB individuals, which leads to increased levels of depression, anxiety, substance use and misuse, and then separately from health disparity data around people of color, which again, similar concerns, and then we add additional mental health concerns. Now try to imagine what it looks like if you happen to be an LGBTQ person of color. But we know in spite of these realities, young queer folk are still showing up ready to ask pointed questions of us as mental health clinicians. I want to share this story that actually strangely happened recently where, as a clinician, part of my practice is when folks reach out to me for services, I want to establish like an initial consultation where I get to know them and allow them to ask me questions that they would not have answers to based on my web presence. And after I gave my spiel about who I am and a little bit about my background, this person asked me point blank, what is your understanding of race, particularly Blackness, within queer Latinx communities? And why do you work with these communities? And I honestly appreciate these types of questions because regardless of my lived experiences, it holds me accountable to do my own work so I can answer these questions truthfully. But when we haven't done our work to provide genuine and nuanced answers, we unintentionally create barriers for these communities who then see us as inaccessible, right? So accessibility, I want to start by saying accessibility isn't only about getting to us, but connecting with us, trusting us, and ultimately working and healing with us. When I do ask prospective questions why they reached out to me specifically, the answers remain consistent. Clients are seeking providers who look like them and may have some lived experience. And yes, again, the research shows that for some folks, the therapist's identities may not matter. But what we do know is that there's a phenomenon called cultural mistrust, which is an arguably protective and adaptive response to surviving centuries of targeted violence by dominant groups. It's real and should be included as an influential factor when engaging in these discussions about barriers and challenges. Now, I think one way to address the specific concern of cultural mistrust is to ask those of us who support these communities to look at the composition of our teams or staff, right? Do they reflect the communities with which you work? If not, ask yourself why this discrepancy exists and acknowledge that this is an identifiable and fixable barrier to care. I'm thinking about my experience of working as a staff psychologist in a university counseling center and observe the emotional labor that one of my colleagues, the lone Black woman on staff, experienced when Black women and Black femmes sought her for care. See, our systems are creating additional challenges for younger queer folks of color by not hiring and retaining staff who look like them and could help shape policies with their unique concerns in mind.